Could you give at Marks with Mike's podcast a shout out? Shout out!
Hey, yo!
What a maneuver! Mamma mia! Mamma mia! Are you kidding me?
The irresistible force meeting the immovable object.
Welcome to an episode of Marks with Mike's. You already know it's by the sound of my voice. That's right, it's your boy, Mr. 6'9". JT back in this piece once again. And, of course, I am rolling with 2 out of 3 of the co-hosts. First of all, I got to say what's up to El Cheech.
My elbow, my other elbow, and what's that other thing we've been complaining about? Our back, because we've been carrying this podcast. Hell, what's going on?
Not much, man. You know, like I used to say, laying in the cut like a Band-Aid, trying to make sure I'm just cooling it. And, of course, returning back to the show, feeling a little bit better. And, of course, walking on sunshine, it's the Prodigy. What's up, Conor?
Good evening, gentlemen. It's been a minute, but the Prodigy's back, so El Cheech can rest his back for a little bit. I'll take some of the load, and let's get this ball rolling. It was a good week.
Man, listen, it was a good week. First of all, new things popping, big things stopping, little shit stopping. Inauguration, got a new president. Ain't no more Trump, bitch. And also, you know what I'm saying, we got the most trending meme of all time right now with Bernie Sanders fucking everywhere.
The mitten?
Fucking everywhere, yo. Like, they had this motherfucker in movie scenes, The Color Purple, WrestleMania matches, Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, you name it. But, you know, definitely got to thank you all for tuning in last week to, of course, the podcast. Make sure you continue to do what you do. And all you new listeners, you know what to do. Look, make sure you follow. Make sure you subscribe. Leave us a comment. We are available everywhere where podcasts are available. You already know the list of trios, but I'm going to name a few. Of course, we got Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Amazon Music. And, of course, there's Podbean. There's also CastBox. There's Spreaker. Listen, you get the drift. We are everywhere podcasts are available, and as well on YouTube. But with that being said, it's easy to find us. It's the name of the show. If you're able to find us, you know it's easy to find us on Twitter, IG, and a book of faces. It's at Marks and Mikes, and no, I'm not spelling that shit. Let's go ahead and get started with the show. Speaking of shit, man, my son. My wife was changing my son earlier, man. He took a shit. It was all over his back. She goes to go change him. This guy fucking rolls around the bed and rolls shit all over my comforter. So now there's a comforter that's in the trash because there's literally shit everywhere on a king size comforter. But I did say shit, so let's talk about Raw. I'm sorry. Gotta be honest, man. Raw for the last consecutive 3 weeks now, not starting off real good this year. Just gonna throw that out there.
Well, I'm just save us some time, all right? There was this fucking match between AJ Styles and Ricochet. With that match alone, the show to me was 10 out of 10. Just with that match, fuck everything that happened. AJ Styles, Ricochet, that was Monday Night Raw. Tell me, you guys. Y'all seen that match? What you thought?
I thought it was a really good match. Two of some of the best workers in the business right now, and they killed it. Like, I can agree with you. Pretty much the rest of Raw was pretty unbearable for the most part. Like, I didn't.
Positive vibes only.
As I was saying. I didn't mind the main event with Alexa Bliss and Asuka, but otherwise it was all about just Ricochet and AJ Styles tearing the house down, as was pretty much expected from everybody.
Yo, that finish, JT, tell me you saw that finish.
Yo, man, that finish with the fucking, you know, he's fucking grabs Ricochet, fucking throws him on that top rope, he bounces back. Puts him in the Styles Clash, yo. That has to be one of the best Styles Clashes I've ever seen. And I'm not blowing smoke up anyone's ass, though. Like, if you go back to TNA, New Japan, ROH, there's got to be one of the best. But besides the top rope style splash, this is the best one.
Yo, it was money, like, smooth, you know what I mean? And, you know, Ricochet, you could call him whatever, you know what I mean? He hasn't been, let's say, portrayed or booked like a strong. I mean, he wasn't like a strong wrestler how in the Indies, but, you know, a lot of flippity-flippity, you know, spot monkeys. But, dude, you know what I mean? Dude, nice, you know what I mean? He nice, and he got good chemistry. Let's remind you, just a year ago, he fought Brock Lesnar for the belt on paper, because let's be honest, we already knew what was going to be the ending on that match. But, you know, that match, you know what I mean? It's like you put in Ricochet right there, you know, he's kind of losing or whatever. But to me, they kind of seeing and listening more. Little by little, I'm seeing things going to change. As people are getting booked and the people that need to be booked being booked. But the fact that we ain't seen no Hurt Business, you know what I'm saying? Like, we haven't been seeing it as much. And I guess, you know, that Asuka and Alexa Bliss match was pretty much just a filler just to show Alexa Bliss, growth in that. And that character, you know what I'm saying? Like, other than that, man, we should stay on the positive vibes and just roll over to the next fucking day, man. Unless I got anything else to say about Raw, man. I just don't want to kick him with it down, man.
I mean, I ain't going to kick him while it down, but I am going to say it was good to see Gilbert in that fake...
oh, shit! Yeah! Hey, he still looked the same.
You know what? He looks just like Goldberg right now. Be honest, like it's a mirror. Like it's like looking in the mirror, seeing Gilbert and Goldberg. I mean, perfect. And then Drew McIntyre comes out there with that wig. Other than that, man, it really wasn't nothing popping on Raw. I mean, you know, besides Bobby Lashley stomping on, air quotations, stomping on Matt Riddle's foot. But yeah, nothing really popping on Raw.
Yeah. Hey, did you see that meme? That they got one of the guys, I think, from one of the podcasts made, like with the Bernie Sanders sitting down, Lashley waiting for Brock Lesnar's match.
Yeah. Shout out to Dirty Hills.
Yeah, Dirty Hills, man. Shout out.
Man, listen, we need to book that match ASAP. If you talking about money draw for WrestleMania, if you trying to get those two nights, Lashley versus Lesnar, the end. No other conversation. No title even needed.
Word. But, you know what I mean? Like, we got a lot to talk, man. Tuesday was a day that we wasn't expecting, you know, even though we got the Impact and AEW going. But, my guy, Impact, I mean, we've been speaking on it for a while. You know, get familiar. You know what I mean? We've been on that train, that boat. Right, JT?
Hell yeah, I've been saying it for almost a year. Listen, if you're sleeping on Impact, wake the fuck up.
Dude, yeah, you know what I'm saying? Like, that was fucking, you know what I mean? Unexpected, but unexpected. But, you know, Prodigy, speak on that Impact, man.
Honestly, Impact has been, it's been pretty good lately. I'm not even going to lie. Like, I was more of a skeptical than most people when it comes to Impact Wrestling, just because after a while I thought it was really, really just bad wrestling. But now that I'm watching it more, like, it's becoming very consistent. Like, to me, it should be competing with an AEW or a NXT, just in terms of, like, if they had, like, a broader reach for views. But being on Access TV is kind of tough. But honestly, this week's, it wasn't bad. Like, I actually really enjoyed it. I don't know. How did you guys feel about it?
I give it a 7.
hey, my man! The wildest son. No, but it was a hell of a match. But, you know what I mean? It kind of brushed through. You know, the first match, you had a fucking Rhino against Eric Young. How you like that name of that stable, you know what I mean?
I mean, I can roll with it. I mean, it ain't bad and ain't good, but it ain't.
It's like, you know what I mean? It's not PG. We're giving you violence, but you know what I mean? Just having that name in the as a name of state was kind of like.
I can agree with that. I feel like with today's like stable names and things like that, that's probably one of my least favorites. Like, I'm sorry, it can just be a hell of a lot better.
Hell yeah. But you know what I mean? You had you know, of course Alice Shelley got hurt, you know, so you got the tag teams being you know what I mean, a major focus in the company. So, you know, you had the Good Brothers, you know what I mean, in the ring. And then you have, you know what I mean, I guess they fought together before, right?
The Cowboy, James Storm and Chris Sabin.
Beer gun.
Damn luck.
Yeah, I think that was kind of dope. But wait, there's more.
Yeah, man, the fucking, Money Matt Hardy comes through. He brings the Private Party, and apparently the Private Party are heels in Impact. And we end up with Money Matt Hardy booking a match between Private Party and James Storm and Chris Sabin for the number one contenders. Like, what the fuck?
Yeah, it's like you just come in to another company, but you know what I mean? Like he said, you know, since the barriers, you know, the frontiers are open or whatever. I didn't expect that. And like, you know, we spoke about it and I wasn't like too thrilled, but you know, it's kind of cool or whatever. What transpired the next day on AEW, we'll be touching on that. Now I'm kind of a little bit more on board. But seeing this, it was like, oh, okay. So that leads to the main event later on, you know. But dude, them guys actually, you know, counting Wednesday, they like Money Matt say they fought in 24 hours. They fought three matches. You know what I mean? They won all three. You know what I mean? And they get in rib. He's taking what 30%, 50%. So, but dudes are putting in work. You know what I'm saying? So, I don't know, do you, you know what I'm saying, you know what I mean, we're going to touch on the main event in a little bit, right? So, let's talk about that Moose and Swan.
Go ahead, speak on the Prodigy.
The Moose and Swan match?
Well, it wasn't more of a match, it was more like an altercation, like, you know.
Yeah, a confrontation, yeah. I'm all for it. I'm a huge fan of Moose. I think this is going to be a good move. Like, I think that, I don't know, it might be me, but I feel like they might be rushing it a little quickly. I was hoping more of like a bigger build up to a match between the two, but what do you guys think? Do you think they're rushing this a bit, or you think this is like flowing pretty well?
Well, it's been boiling for quite some time, you know what I mean? Even though he got the TNA, you know, he claims to be the TNA champion. So, you know, that was a major belt. Swan got the Impact belt, you know, so it was, they on a collision course, you know what I mean? It was inevitable, you know what I mean? Like, to me, it's just kind of like a backup, as in, like, what's going to be happening, because, you know what I mean? The other one that you think might happen is Omega against Swan, eventually, you know what I mean? But to me, it was cool, because, you know, they had the altercation, you know what I mean? So, I'm not quite sure, if, you know what I mean, how soon would they be facing, but, you know, the storyline might come out good, because it's like, Moose need that, and perhaps they'll probably put the belt on Moose and have Moose fight Omega, you know what I mean? So, but Big Man, what's your thoughts on Moose and Swan?
First of all, I got to correct you. There is no claim to be. Moose is the TNA heavyweight champion. And might I add, it's the better looking title. All right?
That shit is hideous.
Are you crazy?
That shit is hideous.
The TNA championship looks 10 times better than that big ass fucking owl on Impact title. No, nobody wants to see that big ass owl on the Impact title. I mean, come on now. Big ass owl on Impact title. Come on. But no.
Yeah.
I like it. I don't think they rushing it. They have been kind of alluding to it for a while. But with everything that's going on, you got AEW with the invasion with Kenny Omega. And then, you know, you got this whole thing going where it looks like Kenny's going to collect the Impact Championship. But I kind of feel like your bigger money draw would be a Moose versus Omega. But at the same time, I think Rich Swann is also a big money draw as well as Impact Champion. So I don't know how they're going to play it, but let's just say Rich Swann does capture that title. I'm sorry, take that back, scratch that. Let's just say that Kenny Omega does capture the Impact Championship. Does Moose go and defend the TNA Heavyweight Championship against Kenny Omega? Like, is that one of the Infinity Stones that goes on the wrist of Kenny Omega inside this Wrestling Infinity War? Like, I don't know.
I wouldn't mind seeing Moose versus Omega personally. It's just that'd be more to think about. It, that'd be pretty damn cool, in my opinion.
Yeah, me personally, I could be mistaken, but I think Swan and Omega had faced each other, you know, sometime in a different, you know, universe. I'm not sure if they did or if it was like a one-on-one. I'm pretty sure they had probably in Ring of Honor sometimes. But yeah, like you said, they both got equity, you know what I mean? But I think size wise, like Moose, that persona is kind of that slow talk or whatever, you know, I dig it. But you know, he is that a lift? Is that the lift he got? Oh no, he don't got a lift. What is it? He got like a heavy tongue?
Heavy tongue, possibly so, but you know, like, but at the same time, Cheech is like this here, bro. Like, okay, whether you know Moose and Omega never fought or not, you know, and if you're looking at size wise, come on, bro. AEW got people that is barely over 200 pounds and barely over, you know, 6'1. So I don't want to hear nothing about size. I think that it's either way, it's a big win for both companies, no matter who he faces or if Omega faces both. I just know that at the end of the day, we got Private Party as the number one contenders for the TNA Tag Team Championships.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Might as well dive right into that, but I just want to say that I guess, you know, as we all know, Taya Valkyrie was found guilty for shooting Bravo, right?
Oh. And,
so I guess that's she's going to jail. So that's how she's being written off. And I don't know how it works over there, you know, the 90-day policy or whatever, but I wouldn't mind seeing Taya popping at the Rumble.
Yep. I'm all for it. I'm with it. If she could pop up at the Women's Royal Rumble, and let's just say that her contract just runs out and she's able to compete, instead of like, you know, you have to wait 90 days until you, I think it's like with them, if you get fired, you got to wait 90 days. I don't think it's if your contract runs out, you got to wait 90 days. But if that's the case, definitely see her show up in the Rumble. Real talk. Got to see her inside the Rumble. I'm with that one.
Yeah, definitely, brother. That's dope, man. And what y'all thought when you know, when you see Tony Khan, you know what I mean, all in the video, you know what I mean? But you got fucking Jerry Lynn, you know what I mean? Oh shit, you know, I remember he was doing referee, now he's like a, you know, like a back agent or whatever. And they say they're gonna be sitting ringside for the main event, you know what I mean? And take notes. But bro, what transpired in that main event? Brother, speak on it, JT.
There's a lot that we can say about Impact. First of all, all up inside the videos and all that stuff. Find it ironic that Tony Khan says, hey, I don't want to be an on-screen character for, you know, AEW, but you're an on-screen character for Impact. Makes zero sense.
Whoa, hold it there. Remember when, I'm not comparing it, but just to some extent, when Vince started doing his heel character, he didn't do it in WWE first. You know what I mean? He did it in Memphis with Lawler, his company over there. That's when they started seeing the heel persona, you know? But, it's kind of dope. I like it because it's kind of like it's something different that you're not going to see there. But, you know what I mean? And in a way, on some real shit, it's like looking out for Impact. You know what I'm saying? Because, like, some people just might be want to see dude just fuck up or whatever. You know what I'm saying? But, dude, man, like, that match, you know what I mean? The kids, you know what I mean? They're looking a lot better. I'm glad they changed that gear, the hideous gear they used to have before. Now they're a little bit better. But, man.
I mean, I'm with it. You know, they hit them with the gin and juice for the win. And, you know, I'm happy about that. You know, I'm definitely happy that they're getting some type of push. I just kind of feel like that. Why aren't they number one contenders for the tag team championships in AEW? Being that the fact that they beat the Young Bucks last year for that very same spot to even to contend for the tag team championships. But that's another story.
That match, I want to touch on the ending of that match. You know what I mean? It seems like, you know, Beer Guns had the upper hand. Bro, then you have Jerry Lynn. You know what I mean? Come in and cause Beer Guns the match. And this guy's hit the gin and juice to finish, you know what I mean, with the help of, you know what I mean, from J.E.L., you know what I mean? So right there, you started seeing the more flashes of heels for the Private Party, bro. And it was so smooth because, Jerry Lynn came in and held one of the guy's legs. Bro, the transition to that gin and juice was money. You know what I mean? But that ending right there, and I was going to ask you guys what y'all thought about that involvement of Jerry Lynn.
Real quickly, like, I'm excited just because I always thought that Jerry Lynn was a very underrated talent. And to see him get involved just with that little bit right there, hopefully that's a teaser for more to come. So if it involves Jerry Lynn, I'm all for it.
I second that motion. Like, it's good to have Jerry back on TV. You know, even if he doesn't wrestle, just involvement as an OG, as a legend, I think that's good for the business. You know, former TNA wrestler, former ECW wrestler. So, you know, there's a lot that goes into the namesake. But, you know, this heel turn was definitely coming. Matt Hardy ain't the only person gonna turn heel. Like, you know, if this my teacher, whatever my teacher do, I do. So at the same time, I'm happy for Private Party. Maybe we get some type of thing where we have Impact titles on AEW and Private Party's only. So who knows? But before we move on anywhere else, look, we gotta take a real quick break. When we come back, we'll be talking about, of course, MLW, NXT, and, of course, AEW, and the best damn wrestling show of the week, SmackDown. But let's take this quick break. What's up, y'all? Listen, I got to tell y'all about Anchor. Anchor is one of the easiest platforms you can use to go ahead and make your podcast. First of all, it's free. Second of all, it's free. Third of all, did I mention that it's free? Go ahead and download the Anchor app inside your app store. You can go ahead and get your podcast on many platforms such as Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and many more platforms. Anchor has all the tools that you need right at the palm of your hand. What you waiting for? Go ahead and download Anchor and start your podcast. And we are back. Yo. definitely thank you all for tuning in. It's easy. You know what to do. It says it right inside of the ad. I'm not going to tell you how to record a podcast. If you listen to the ad, it just tells you how to do it. All right. Let's go ahead and move on. Yo, Wednesday nights are stacked. All right. They are very, very stacked. And with that being said, there's a lot that goes on. I mean, you got about three companies, you know what I'm saying, running on one night. You got, of course, MLW, which, of course, has been doing magnificent things with their product since they've came back. I mean, hands down, I'm very happy to see them back. But there's a couple moments that we definitely got to talk about, man. We got to talk about from MLW. So first and foremost, got to say shout out to the new tag team champions, Los Sparks. Definitely back inside the building. And so, Cheech, I'm not going to fuck this up. Go ahead and say her name.
Producciones Dorado. Salina de la Renta.
The more you know, ladies and gentlemen, the more you know. But yeah, MLW, of course, back, of course, hitting everybody in the mouth as they usually do. Had a couple big matches on there. First of all, one match that I was very hyped to see, ACH versus Jacob Fatu Contra, back inside the building. Yo, you've been on this Contra wave since MLW popped back up a few years ago. So tell me how this story has definitely evolved since they've been back, because Now you throw in a heavy and a ripped ass Daivari. Like, is this more of an evolution of Contra, or you think it's regressing, Cheech?
Just like you said, it's just like regressive, you know, like they growing, you know, and then, you know, they're getting bigger, they're like expanding. You know, even though they still have the ones that, let's say, they got, you know, a lot of them, because that's the way they always made it seem, that there's way more, but that's the ones that come forward. So the fact that they, more come, it doesn't mean that they just knew. They've always been there, you know what I mean? And I like that, how they portray that. But that dude, Jacob Fatu, you know what I mean? That size, he's not always doing flips and all this crazy shit, but when he do, that's when it matters. And man, Jacob Fatu is that dude. And shout out to ACH, you know what I mean? He's back wrestling and shit, but all hail Contra, bro.
All hail Contra, man. I mean, Contra's big, man. I mean, you got Daivari, like I said, he's inside of it. You know, Daivari picked up his dub that night as well. And then backstage, Injustice jumped Contra. Like, I love that. I love the fact that they end up, you know, basically, you know, it won Contra.
An open hand. They had the last open hand, you know what I mean? The last laugh. But now it's going to be hell to pay.
Yeah, because Injustice is not that big of a stable, man. I mean, you know what I mean? It's like Contra got numbers. It's a lot of them motherfuckers. And it's like, if you're going to go out and, you know, plan on jumping somebody, make sure you got plenty of backup. But speaking of MLW, somebody made a return. Former guest on the show, Speak on it, Cheech. El Cheech.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. Deep and I ran over here. Yeah, man. Good old Tio Savio. You know, he cut a little promo, you know, going on holiday. He's coming back. You know what I'm saying? He won that belt back. So, you know, for those to know, you know, one of his, I guess, you know, matches that he whatchamacallit perfected the dog collar, you know, match. And he said he's bringing the one he used with old, good old Stone Cold Steve Austin. I thought that was kind of dope, you know what I'm saying? That little tidbit there. So this coming Wednesday, you know, you're going to have Tio Savio, you know, with a match with Mike Holiday. And to me, that's a bigger because that's, you know, Mike Holiday working with a type of wrestler like Savio. You know what I mean? He's learning. You know, and that's going to help him because he's young. You know, he's going to be in this for the long haul. But, yeah, I popped when I saw my boy.
Yeah, man, representing the IWA. But, you know, got a Caribbean scrap match next week on MLW. Cannot wait to see that. So MLW, of course, delivered like they usually do on time. If it ain't on time, money back guaranteed. You know, you had a grudge match between Jordan Oliver and Simon Gouch, which, you know, of course, ended up being another classic between these two. Unfortunately, Simon Gouch with the dub on this one. But, yo, relentless with the attack after the match. Just basically laying it in until Jordan Oliver, like, literally. And then does the pile driver on the canvas. I like the Simon Gouch versus the Von Villains, Simon Gouch. This Simon Gouch, I don't think should leave MLW anytime soon. I like what they're doing with him. So that's definitely good. But, you know, overall, if I had to, you know, rate MLW for this past week, definitely, you know, I give them like a 7, you know.
You ended up like them 7.
Yo, 7's the lucky number, yo. 7's the lucky number.
All right. Yeah, I'm good.
Let's move on to, of course, that next show on Wednesday, depending on which one you watch first. But since we go in alphabetical order, well, we're not really. But anywho, let's go talk about AEW Dynamite.
Yeah, Prodigy. What you thought about this past episode of Dynamite, you know what I mean? And how, you know what I mean? Regardless of what, it was great, you know, think that they doing for, you know, John Hill's son and the way they include him, you know what I mean? And how the show started, it was, I don't know, man. What you guys thought about the opening?
I appreciated the opening just because it shows that they really respected John Huber or Brody Lee or Luke Harper, whatever you want to call him, John Huber, and they want to make sure that his family's taken care of and things like that. It's just, I don't know about you guys, but I really hope they don't pull like a WWE or anything and just like have the family like constantly like in storylines and things like that, kind of like they did with Guerrero and people like that. It's just like, I really appreciated the intro. It's just, I really hope that they kind of tone it down with constantly having the family on there. But that's just me.
Yeah, I kind of feel like they're going to ride that wave for a while. I mean, you're going to see -1 and more storylines. He's going to be on Dark. He's going to be on Dynamite. They're going to ride that wave. I mean, do we have to get him involved in the storyline continuously? No. Because y'all going to pay the man's family regardless, right? If that's the case, if you're talking about merchandise sales and things of that sort, and you got them on payroll and stuff like that, but do I need to see them every week? No, I mean, I'm glad in the sense that, you know, far as for the therapy that the son is getting, being able to go out there, it's a beautiful, beautiful thing. But does it have to be televised every week? No, it doesn't, because we wasted about, 10 minutes on a birthday segment before we even had a match. And even the buildup for the segment was trash, you know? And, you know, they top it off with a tag team match, which was okay. Wasn't all that. I mean, I don't know, Cheech. You tell me.
What was that?
Nah, I was saying that, you know, I don't think that they need to have, you know, them them on every single week. But the tag team match was all right. I mean, he wasn't on that.
You talking about the Dark Order?
I'm talking about the Dark Order, but I'm talking more so about, you know, putting the family on display every week.
To me, just perhaps the timing, you know, because it's like the first birthday without the sons, you know what I mean? You know, it's like he had plans with his father, you know, for his birthday, and I don't know, you know what I mean? Like, so now I understand. Moving forward is going to be different, you know what I mean? But then again, remember, this company's pretty much, you know, being the Elite, the last few months, it's been literally the Dark Order fucking, you know, being, spotted, like, you know, the spotlight been on them, you know, and unfortunately events, and you see people, you know, YouTube comments or whatever, and they, you know what I mean, they like John Silver, they like the, you know what I mean, and it's, you know, man, long as, let's say you got the fans and everybody on social media backing them up, I think they're going to capitalize on that, and you know, that little thing that, you know, they fucked up, you know what I mean, with that. You know, if Hangman Page is going to join, it was kind of like, you know what I mean? You see, they got the comic thing, but, you know, Page don't need to be in no crew. You know what I mean? He needs to be on his dolo tip and shit. But, you know, it was kind of, you know, it was funny, you know what I mean? You know, but hopefully moving forward, you know what I mean? Hopefully, if they are, you know what I mean, like, shown, it would be more like in a lesser way. Because then next week, you know what I mean, the Good Brothers and the Young Bucks, they fight in the Dark Order. You know what I mean? So that's spotlight, you know what I mean? They're not doing it for no reason. They're doing it for a reason. So it's kind of hard to tell, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, I don't know. It's hard on that one on me because, like, I never seen nothing like that. And the fact that they actually been so into helping the family like that, man.
Right.
So it's like mad props, you know what I'm saying? They doing it, you know?
Yeah. Don't get me wrong. Like, I give them props. I mean, like you said, the timing and everything with the kid's birthday. But, you know, like I said, moving forward, anything after that, I'm just going to feel like that they're kind of milking it. Not so much in a sense of just, you know, hey, we're doing this for his memory, but more so kind of milking the situation in a sense, you know. And like Connor said, like, I don't want them to do no Mysterio type of storyline at all. But, you know, it's wrestling. Anything happens. But it's always good to, you know, to see people get TV time, I guess. I mean, you got Hybrid 2, Chaos Project, you know, Dark Order. But yeah, you're right. Hangman Page should never be in a company spiel. But moving on, next match. You had Peter Avalon versus Cody Rhodes. Cody Rhodes and that Alpha theme music, that Alpha remix. Just plain trash by Suda. Wiggity whack. Yes.
What are you talking about? Bro, my man. Okay. All right, big man. You know, big man. Big man. If you get hit in the balls, you know, you'll be gone down for a while. You know what I'm saying? Good 5 minutes, depending. If you get hit that hard. You know what I mean? The match literally starts like that, kind of. You know what I'm saying? This dude hit him, Avalon, hit him in the jewels. You know what I mean? He was up within, you know what I mean? Like, nothing happened. You know what I mean? And
balls of steel.
Yeah, like, what the fuck? It's like, come on, man. It's like little shit like that kind of throws me away, but. You know, they had that particular match, but I guess just to expose the people that they had. But then you have Jay pop up again, man. Damn, she's a tank.
Yeah, man. It's like, I was not invested in that match at all. I mean, the theme music lost me. honestly. And I love Snoop. I mean, Snoop is easily inside my top five. Top five best MCs of all time.
But to me, I'm about to cut you off. But to me, that they doing it just because they had that show. They just premiered the other day or whatever. You know what I mean? Just the connection. But I'm pretty sure he's going to, you know, they're going to go back to that. You know what I mean? To his old one.
I mean, you are you sure it's just because of the show, or is
I want to think so.
I mean, you don't think it's because, I don't know, WWE has Snoop Dogg on side of a wrestler's theme song, Sasha Banks, and well, hey, why don't we do something with Cody, and let's put one for AEW. It's like, don't get me wrong, money talk bullshit, walk a marathon, but at the end of the day, bro, was it needed? No. I mean, we already had the crossover. We already had the crossover with Snoop on New Year's Smash.
And that was because of that, just pretty much, because I believe Snoop Dogg is executive producer of that show too. So he's there to promote, you know what I mean? So to me, just something just for the show. And, you know, they're going to change. I don't think that's going to be the song going forward. You know what I'm saying? It's just now pretty much just to you show like, you know what I mean? Snoop Dogg, fuck with us. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Basically, hey, he fuck with us too. It's like, yo, it's like, I didn't need it. I didn't. I understand. But it's cool. But the match itself, Peter Avila, first of all, one of the first people that they signed. Why is he just now getting some type of motion with them? That's my big gripe. They started him out as the librarian, then there were two librarians, and now he was the solo librarian. Now he's, you know, by himself. Like, he's too good of a wrestler to be going through that. But once again, Cody has balls of steel. Jade is back creeping around. Apparently, Shaq is looking for her to, in the words of Cheech, spread his seed.
Push her seed in her bush for life.
Oh my gosh, yo, Prodigy, yo, what did you think about, like, what's going on with this Jade thing? I mean, I know they're trying to build something. I mean, since Brandy, of course, can't fight because she's Prego, why not get Brandy Jr. and Red Velvet to go up against Jade? But what's going to come of this? Like, is there any solidness inside the storyline, or is it all over the place?
I don't know. For me, I felt like it's very all over the place. Like, I don't think they really, or at least it's not coming together right now, but I feel like there's so much happening at once. It's becoming very convoluted. And for me, it's just hard to keep up. Like, who do they want to go with this? Like, I have zero clue. Like, I don't know. What do you think about this, Cheech?
Shaggy? Soinks? I don't have a clue, bro. We don't know. I'm pretty sure it's like we have this specimen right here of a woman. You know, we got to put it out there. But I don't know where the storyline, because of course it was Brandy, and of course, you know what I mean? I don't think Brandy has the most fans. You know what I mean? They want to see her on TV. There's a lot, you know what I mean? Like, you say Taya. You know what I mean? Even though her dude is in WWE, you never know. She probably, you know what I mean? Money talks, you know what I mean? So we don't know. We still have Homegirl. I forgot her name. Tully Blanchard's daughter. What's her name again? I forgot her name.
Tessa
Blanchard. That, you know what I mean? I just don't know. But to me, it's more like, yo, we got this. It's just, you know, it's all about perception and how you see, you know what I mean, what you see on TV. It's like, yo, you know, you're going to be talking about, she got the sex appeal, but also, you know what I mean, she looked like a fucking tank, you know what I mean, like a machine. So, you know, like, to answer your question. I don't know what the fuck going on.
No one knows what this means now, but you know, the other things popped off on, of course, Dynamite. I mean, you had, of course, Moxley back on the television screen inside of his first match since losing the title. You know what I'm saying? Which is, you know, dope, I guess. Having him back, that's good. You know, having him back is good, but at the same time, yo, I kind of feel like he didn't have to put him to sleep like that, because my man was asleep less than my man was like, the match didn't even go that long, like knockout sleep, that was over with. But yeah, he put him to sleep. Moved on from there. You had Private Party and Matt Hardy going up against Top Flight and Matt Sydal. Of course, Snoop Dogg inside the back. You know, Snoop Dogg got the chance. Well, from last week, Snoop Dogg got the chance to hang out with Private Party. So I don't know. Maybe Private Party has some of that good cushion. They got that fucking inside their system.
The gin and juice.
Yeah. I mean, the gin and juice. I mean, yo, they probably had some of Snoop's new gin, indigo or whatever the name of it is, but probably had some of that new gin, hit some cuz. I was like, you know what, fuck it, we gonna be heels. But Private Party, Matt Hardy, Top Flight, Matt Sydal. Yeah. I mean, the match was all over the place, bro. I'm not gonna lie, like there were a couple spots in that match I didn't know if they knew what they were doing. There was too many flips, too many dips, too many non-tags. Like, I don't know. Like, that match was all over the place. It was like a chef in the kitchen and just basically throwing all of the seasonings inside there just to make sure they taste good. But it was everywhere.
Like a jambalaya.
Yeah, but the jambalaya wasn't that good. Like, it was just too much going on. Like, way too much. Like, a lot. It was a lot of spots in there. Like, no one knew what they were supposed to do next.
I know, but man, that chair, you know what I mean? Like, I kind of like, oh, okay. I kind of like this, you know? Like, I'm kind of on board. Like I was saying, from the night before Impact, I was kind of, whatever, not to. But then seeing the next day, like, oh, okay. I kind of like the direction they're going, you know what I mean? And, you know, they got another win. Like I said, 3 wins in 24 hours. You know, that's kind of impressive, I guess. And Idaho.
Very impressive indeed. What did you think about that tag match, Prodigy?
For what it was all right. I don't know. Just, I don't know about you guys, but I'm kind of getting burnt out on all these, like, extended tag matches in AEW. Like, I get it. Their tag division is probably the best right now, but they have, like, these just constant tag matches, 6-man tag matches, 8-man tag matches, like, all these tag matches. It's just, but you know, so annoying.
My bad to cut you up, but, like, if you think about it, the guys that, you know, the pillars of the company, where they come from, they came from doing business in Japan. And if you notice, watching Japan, they do that a lot. In Mexico, they do it a lot too. Multiple people just to put them on the card, I guess, you know what I mean? But, yeah, I understand. It's just too much, you know what I mean? It's like a clusterfuck. We're going to have another clusterfuck next week. With the good brothers and the blah, 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 the elite and all that shit.
Yeah, like I said, it's good, don't get me wrong, but like anything else, too much of a good thing just ends up leading to a spoiled appetite, and I feel like at this point with all these tag matches and stuff, it's kind of spoiling it for me.
I second that motion, because guess what? There was another tag team match later. MJF and Chris Jericho versus Santino and Santana and Ortiz and Sammy
Hagar. You seen that shit? With Sam Hagar came out, you know what I mean?
Sam Hagar.
That was kind of dope, but yes, that match, I understand, but to see how over they are that they were able to book a match like that with all heels, you know what I mean, and make them, you know what I mean, look like important and shit. But it kind of takes away from the actual real tag team that is Proud and Powerful. You know what I'm saying? Santana and Ortiz.
Oh, you're talking about the tag team. They haven't done anything within a year as far as putting them inside an actual tag team match to win the titles. You're talking about that very same tag team that they bought in for a big spot for Double or Nothing. And then after that, they did absolutely nothing with and just had them just be Chris Jericho's heavies and be inside a tag team match with the Best Friends. But other than that, nothing else has been done with those guys.
Lost in the sauce, you know? And yeah, the same ones. So I kind of took away from that. But what I like from this is the progression of Sammy Guevara breaking away from that group and being a face. And him, MJF storyline from the get-go, he didn't like him. You know what I mean? And as you can see, MJF is going to take over the Inner Circle. You know what I mean? I'm saying it right now. And you know, that's going to be a feud that, you know, for years to come, you know, Sammy Guevara versus MJF. And let's keep it 100. Sammy Guevara could go. And we haven't been seeing him a lot lately. You know, he's been in dark or whatever, but intacting. But, you know, once they let him go, you know, it's going to be kind of, you know, it's going to be kind of fun. You know what I mean? But because as we spoke last week, you know what I mean? On that Twitter, you know what I mean? We're going with against T-Bar.
Yeah, I mean, he can go. He can definitely go. But once again, another tag match. Yeah, they were able to book all these heels against each other. But at the end of the day, who ends up with the win? MJF and Jericho. And I was just as interested in that match as I was seeing Chris Jericho do a lion salt.
Hey, who he pinned? Who the NJA pinned?
Guevara. Roll up.
And not just a roll up. He was holding on to tight. Am I correct?
Yeah, he was holding on to tight, but he's a heel. That's what heels do.
Bro, that storyline is written itself. You know what I mean? They could go back and look off to all that shit. You know what I mean? That's something I could say in an AEW short lifespan. That's that match I'm looking forward to. Right there. Right there.
And I'm looking forward to Chris Jericho never doing the lion salt again.
What the fuck happened? What happened?
It literally looked like he stepped on the rope and then he just rolled off the rope. Like, there was no jump or leap or anything. Like, why? Please stop.
It was inauguration, man. Inauguration took so much out of him.
It was Antifa.
It was fucking Biden's running the country. Ah, fuck it. I don't know, man. I mean, people gave him a lot of gripe, but I'll tell you what happened.
Yeah, they are, because remember too. Remember he had he had a concert out in that place where WCW used to do Roll Wild. What was that place called?
Sturgis.
Yeah, Sturgis.
Yeah, and come to find out not that long ago, he admitted that he had coronavirus, and it was around that time. You know what I mean? But I guess he did everything, because, you know, nowadays, like, they just do, you know, they'll film Tuesdays and Wednesdays for weeks. You know what I mean? So perhaps he had the time, you know, I don't know. But, like, you know what I mean? He's cool, but that's the thing, the greatness of Jericho, that even though he be doing, you know what I mean, doing some dumb shit, like, his greatness is so much that he kind of get brushed under the rug, you know what I mean? And but still, he still gets it, because, you know, Jim Cornette, hey, you know what I mean, he be going at him. But all this shit, we all know that he was a Trump supporter, you know what I mean? And that could, you know, with this, the way the world is now. It's like teams, you know what I mean? You're either with this team or this team. And most of the people like that, they don't even know shit about politics, you know? But division, that's all they're trying to do. But yeah, man, AEW, it was a 7.
You gave it a 7? I was going to go with a 6. No, but not 7. It was definitely a 7. What about you, Connor?
Again, like, it was okay. Just, I'm getting burnt out on all the tag matches, so personally, I'd probably give it like a 6. That's just me.
Well, it was another tag team match player, because if you want to talk about tag team matches, why not even talk about even more what we had going on NXT with the Dusty Cup? And to kick off the show, guess what we had, Connor? Guess what we had, bro?
I'm going to go on a limb and say a tag match.
Another tag team match player.
Player!
Teddy Long is booking both NXT and AEW on the same night. No one works even harder. But, Teddy Long books his tag team match with the Dusty Cup. You have The Way, Johnny Gargano, Austin Theory going up against Kushida and Leon Ruff. First of all, shout out to Kushida for pointing at titles that he's not going to get. He pointed at the Cruiserweight title, still ain't got it. Now he's pointing at the North American Championship, and guess what? Never going to get it. Never going to get it. No, not this time. Don't say that. Thank you. Someone got the reference. But, yeah. Kushida and Ruff end up coming out on top, bro. And not even gonna lie, bro. I like this tag team, even though they're not even a real tag team. That's crazy. That's crazy. Yo. Like, Kushida, I like the fact that they turned them a little bit more darker, you know, far as bringing out more elements from New Japan. But keep them that way. Like, don't ever change them back. Like, I like the whole Marty McFly Back to the Future theme and, you know, entrance. But Kushida need to come out and just wreck shop. And this is no takeaway from Leon Ruff either. Like, both of these guys did a great job in this match. Good job. But unfortunately, you know what I'm saying? Kushida end up hitting Gargano with the DDT outside, and you know, it was kind of a wrap from there. You know, Theory couldn't even make the save, and that was it, my dude. That was it. Clean pin. Move on to the next match. Karrion Kross, Killer Kross, going up against Ashanti the Adonis. I like this Ashanti character, but they don't give him no push. It's like, I understand you're trying to build characters, but you can't drop them out every week. I mean, yeah, you're going to build sympathy for them, but at the same time, like, if you continue to do it, people just not going to care about the character. That's just my thinking.
And then, unfortunately, let's keep it 100. How many people... From five, how many people do you know that they actually watched 205 Live?
Probably then they watched 205 Live.
Oh, okay. See, that's just about less than 5 people, you know. And I think he'd been there. Shout out to Pop and Dan, by the way, Pop and Dan. And I think, you know, 205, you know what I'm saying? Like, I remind you, yeah, they did. They in 205, they've been doing the Dusty Rhodes, you know, for the women and the males. But do you think that bracket was big? It was too many teams? Or are you okay with that setting? Because there's, like, too many teams that it's like, you know, they don't have a chance in hell. I mean, I'll be mad if they actually Kushida and Cheeseburger wins it. I know that's not Cheeseburger, but let's go with Cheeseburger.
I mean, I see what they're trying to do. I mean, kind of like that AEW thing that we just discussed, just putting people on TV, giving them TV time. But at the same time, I mean, it's a tournament, right? So why not? You gotta have some fillers inside there to build a story, right? You know, like one team that I thought that was going to go pretty far was, you know, of course, fucking gosh, what is this guy's name? Damn, just on the tip of my tongue, the Fashion Police. Those two guys, I thought they were going to go pretty far between Breezango, but of course they went up against the UE, so it was like, well, they're not going to go nowhere. But yeah, you need some filler guys. You need fillers in order to advance these people. So, you know, do I think that we should be having tag team matches on 205 Live, like a tournament? No, but at the same time, anything that they can do for 205 Live to breathe life into it, do it. But I don't know, man. Cross pretty much, I mean, this match wasn't even a real match. You know, pretty much dominated them. Then you had Imperium going up against the Lucha House Party. Now that was a dope match, and I cannot believe that Imperium did not win this match, yo. Like, former tag team champions, NXT tag team champions, and they lose? They lose, bro. What, were you expecting Imperium to lose this early on inside the tournament, Connor?
Absolutely not. I honestly thought they would have gone pretty deep in the tournament. Like, no disrespect to Lucha House Party, but I would have expected them to lose more in the earlier stages of this because, let's face it, they're not always built up to be the best team. And like you said, Imperium were former champs and everything like that. You would think they would have made it, but it was a cool match. It was just that ending was a little unexpected, if you ask me. Like, I honestly thought that should have been an Imperium win.
Yeah, I think Regal going to have to review the film or something because I think Imperium should have went over inside that match. But then again, we discussed it on last week's show or a couple weeks ago. Like, okay, it wasn't going to be a one-off of Lucha House Party, so if you're going to use them, if you're going to use them, utilize them the right way because, you know, Lucha House Party, I think, will strive better on NXT than they would the main roster. Well, Raw or SmackDown. I don't want to say the main roster. Adam Cole may be listening and may be mad. But, yeah, I think they will strive better in an NXT setting. But, I mean, definitely a good match. I like seeing these two work together. Grand Master Leek and let's say Dorado. Like, seeing those two work together, they got good chemistry. I don't know why they haven't held any gold yet, but maybe they may go to the finals of this. Maybe we may get them in the finals. I don't know.
You know, and the thing is, that matchup right there, you know, of course, regardless, you know, ratings or whatever, but you know, wrestling, that's NXT expertise. And don't do that. That's the thing. I think they, little by little, they realizing what they have. You know what I mean? I don't know. Hopefully, it's like a pump fake and they don't keep putting the brakes on shit. But the Lucha, you know what I mean? That Grand Metal League, man. That guy, bro, he can't do no wrong. You know what I mean? It's just his type of style. Yeah, it's going to be a little, you know, little bumps and stuff like that. Little wrestle botch stuff. But the dude could go, you know what I mean? And Lince Dorado's been there for a minute. And, I mean, it's for a reason. The dude, you know what I mean, he's nice. He could make you look good, too. And that, me personally, I didn't expect that, you know, for them to win. So, to me, I was kind of, oh, that's awesome. You know what I mean? Do something with them. You know what I mean? And, you know, you got the Latino, market. So why not capitalize on that? You know what I mean? But that was good. That was good.
Why not? Hey, do what you can while you can do it, while these guys are healthy, right? But moving on from there, you got the women's tag team match. Like I said, more tag team wrestling, Connor. Your favorite tag team wrestling. Everywhere you had, of course, You had, God damn it. You had Mercedes Martinez and Toni Storm going up against Kayden Carter. And what's the chick's name from American Ninja Warrior? What's her name, Connor? Casey.
Oh, it's like Casey Cannizzaro or something like that.
Yeah.
Cannizzaro.
Whatever that dish that you can order at Carrabba's. But yeah. Yeah, but you had Casey and Kayden Carter going up against Toni Storm and Mercedes Martinez, which Carter and Casey end up coming out with the dub on that one, man. I mean, I would have thought it would have been a whole different feel to it. That they probably would have went on further.
But like I was saying again, little by little, they kind of noticing like what, you know what I mean, what they saying over here in different platforms. And if you notice, you know what I mean, them two girls, they heavy on TikTok, you know what I mean? And TikTok is the wave now. So, they, you know what I mean? Like, they pop it. Like, before, you know, it might be that, you know, but, like, to me, that's the reason that they won, you know what I mean? And just because, bro, they TikTok heavy. Like, they people see it, you know what I mean? And you got people who don't follow wrestling, but they TikTok, you know what I mean? And they see them. They're not doing, you know what I mean? So they got followers. So they bring in that. And so they were like, yo, you see how many followers this girl's got? Oh, shit. We got to do something with them girls. You know what I mean?
You are totally right when it comes to that, man. But once again, what is the consolation prize at the end for this women's Dusty Cup tournament? That's what I need.
Oh, they're not like, getting like a title shot? I would think that would be it, right?
They haven't announced it yet. They just said it's the women's Dusty Cup. I know a trophy comes at the end, but what's the consolation prize besides that? I would love a tag team title match. We'll see what happens. But, you know, that match was pretty solid. Not even gonna lie. Like, Casey, with all her athleticism, she's really good. Like, she's come a long way, too. Because remember, she stopped at one point. She just stopped. She didn't know if this was going to be for her or not. And, you know, eventually Ricochet, you know, spoke some words to her, or whoever spoke to her, got her head back into the game, and now she's back. But, you know, of course, a lot of this had to do with interference from Io. But at the same time, it's building up a match. So I'm happy. I'm happy that we get this at the end of the day. Bryce,
do you see Toni Storm?
I mean, I'm gonna see Toni Storm every single time she's on TV. I mean, beautiful young lady, married man, bro. I can't talk about her.
Parker, lucky bastard.
But you had, for the first time in a long time, my man Malcolm Bivens back on TV.
Yeah, man, what the fuck they had that dude, man? Oh my god, that they wasting, you know what I mean? They could be doing some stuff, you know what I mean? It just, I'm telling you, they don't like fucking managers, bro.
I don't know, man, but he's good. I mean, don't just sign him because, you know, he was hot talent and you want to keep him away from the competition, but use dude, man. He got so much talent. I mean, his Twitter game is crazy. His IG game is crazy. Social media is crazy. I mean, just let the man talk. Let him get on the mic, because guess who else I haven't seen on TV? Robert Stone. I haven't seen him either. What happened to the Robert Stone brand? But that's another story. But yeah, you had Bronson Reed going up against Tyler Russ, which was a pretty decent match. I mean, I understand what they're trying to do here, which is pretty much build Bronson Reed up a little bit more as like the next heavy contender for either the North American or the NXT Championship. But don't do it at the expense of people that may possibly have something going for themselves pretty soon. Like a Tyler Rush, you know what I mean? Like, it's going to come. I mean, don't get me wrong. He's a quote-unquote newcomer to NXT. But I kind of think that if you're going to build Reed, you're going to have him go with people that are already established. You know what I mean?
Yeah. But like I said, they got talent and they got to start using it. You know, like Swerve, you know what I mean? My boy. And, you know, they use them here and there, you know what I mean? They got the talent, you know what I mean? And they just need to, you know, get the shit together, you know what I mean? And that talent they have, you know.
Whole bunch of talent.
Then what's the next match?
I mean, there's a match coming up, but it was a segment with Legato de la Fan. No, I fucked that up. No, that's fucked up too.
Repeat after me. Okay. El legado del fantasma. Yeah, you go.
Del fantasma. The more you know. Yo, but that segment was dope. But, yo, the next match, the main event, the fight pit match.
Man, you see the announcer? Do you remember her name?
I don't remember her name.
Yeah, but shout out to her, bro. When she announced them, I was, like, staring at her. And she was like, ah! You know what I mean? Like she felt it. She made me like, oh shit, it's about to go down.
Was this match better than the first fight pit match, Connor?
The first is always the best, but holy shit, this was a good match though. Like, they were beating the piss out of each other. Very good match. Was it better than the first? I personally don't think so, but I don't know about you guys. I thought it was still very damn good.
Yeah, the match was good. You know what I mean? It was hard hitting. It's like, you know, it's like, fuck. Demetri Tasha hasn't won in months. Oh, great. Let's make a pit fight. Okay. He'll get his second fucking win. No, but, man, they could go, man. They could go. And that shows that, you know, Ciampa, you know, after coming back from that neck, you know what I mean? That's good that he, you know, it shows that he, you know, healthy and shit. But, man, that match is crunching. And once again, man, I would love to see Brock and Lesnar and Lashley in one of them joints, but let's not just get my hopes high. But yeah, the match, you know, I it could have been better, you know what I mean? But it's like, you know, it is what it is. But I just hope, like, you know, Tasha, you know what I'm saying, like, be giving the ball more, you know what I'm saying? The dude is like a good wrestler, you know.
Yeah, original member of Imperium as well. But that match was definitely the highlight to me on Wednesday. Like, that was hands down one of the best matches. And I kind of feel like what you said, Cheech, if you're going to do this match between Lesnar and Lashley, it has to be in a fight pit match. But in order for us to build this up, I need to see a fight pit match every 2 months. And either every 2 months or once a month, I have to see a fight pit match to keep building it up. You know what I mean? To give it that prestige, I guess you could say. Because, I mean, what, it's been 4 months since the first one, I guess. I mean, and that Raw, when they had Raw Underground, they could have used the fight pit. But then again, I didn't want Raw taking anything from NXT. But yeah, if you're going to do a fight pit match, I need to have Lashley. I need to have Lesnar. And that's your WrestleMania match right there. But look, NXT, against AEW, damn the ratings, bro. I think this show was just more polished. And it just looked better. It flowed better. NXT looked better. But speaking of the best show of the week, with those 8K cameras giving you that NFL effect, we got to talk about SmackDown. And, yo, my man, you got a lot to say about SmackDown, Cheech. Speak on SmackDown.
Whoa. Let me, you know what I mean? Don't disrespect me. You know what I'm saying? Because if you disrespect me, you disrespect him. You know what I mean? No, but, wow. If Roman Reigns don't win a fucking Emmy, I'm going to be pissed. Yo, Roman fucking Reigns, bro. This guy is money, man. It's the best thing going on, bro. And, bro, he just changed, you know what I mean? Like, everything he was, you know, saying when he started saying about the, you know, this guy complaining, you know, he said like, it took a pandemic, you know, to get me out. I don't miss no days. When he started going, maybe my elbow. Maybe my other elbow. You know what I'm saying? Maybe my kneecap. You know, my other kneecap. And then when he got sick, when he said, you know, what was the other thing I was complaining about? Oh, yeah, my back. Because I've been carrying this. Oh, my God. Carrying this company. You know what I mean? Like, this guy just killed it, brother. You know, and you know what I mean? And he's like, man, I can't, you know what I'm saying? I haven't heard somebody like that on the mic on the consistent basis. You know what I mean? Like that, you know what I mean? Like he said he's thoroughbred, you know what I mean? And it was funny because like he said, like, you know, this is going to be Kevin Owens' final trip to the Island of Relevancy, you know what I mean? I was like, yo, this guy is a fucking savage, bro. You know what I mean? Like, man, he killed it, bro. Like, from, you know, being all soft and pandemic when he got, you know, homeboy came in, but that interaction between, you know, Adam Pearce and Heyman, yeah, he's kind of like, yo, and they're like, I'm from New York, you know what I'm saying? Like, yo, look at this motherfucker.
Yo, when as soon as Heyman said, yo, I'm from New York, I'll beat your ass. Talk about my travel chief, like, literally, yo, real talk. As soon as he said, I'm from New York, the first thing I pictured was a Yankees fitted cap, some Timberland boots, in a bubble coat, like when he said that shit, yo, I'm like, yo, this, yo, like it killed me. Just it's not what he said; it's how he said it. Bro.
No, and the thing you see, Roman's face is, but I'm telling you, Roman Reigns is batting 400. You know what I mean? This dude can't do no wrong, and he's like laughing or like, yo, he's disrespecting you, man. You know, if he's disrespecting you, he's disrespecting me. What you gonna do about it? You feel me? Like, I'm like, yo, man, it's, come on, man. They need an Emmy. It was real fucking tough. Money. Yo,
come on,
Conor,
Prodigy.
What you thought? Prodigy.
I mean, straight up, you guys have said everything. Like, that was amazing. The just Roman being Roman, and then the I'm from New York. I'm like, this just got really interesting. That was just, I don't know. Like, I feel like I'm gushing over here. Like, this was just a freaking awesome promo, and I just, I don't know what else to say besides the fact it was awesome. Like, can we just get this every week, please?
Dude, and the thing is, when I was watching this, I was watching it on my phone. You know, I laid down. I'm like, fuck, I'm not even going to turn on the TV because, you know, I got to go to bed. So I was just watching it on my phone. And I was holding my phone, and I had this big-ass fucking grin smile over, like, in my face, you know what I mean? Because I'm like, yo, this is the best thing I have seen in a long time, you know what I mean? Like, of a promo, you know, and unfortunately, every show starts with a fucking promo, you know what I mean? I don't know why. Why I have to be like that, you know what I mean? Dude, that promo was fucking awesome, and what that led to, you know, it was awesome. I could keep talking. Yeah, just let me know, man.
Yeah, shit was gold. Shit was definitely gold. But, you know, hey, if you seen that, everybody know that one person from New York. The first thing they say, I'm from New York, I'll beat your ass. So, if you hear that.
Oh, that's a shirt.
Yeah,
that's a shirt.
All day.
Yeah, but we're going to go back to that. But, brother, you know, you got Daniel Bryan coming out. I don't know about y'all, but I kind of feel like he's one of the favorites to win the Rumble. Do y'all second that?
Yeah, I second it. I think we'll end up having Roman Reigns versus Daniel Bryan.
Yeah, so, you know, you have him talking on the stick, you know what I mean? And, you know, prior to that, of course, you know, you got Sami Zayn got doing his shenanigans. I think he's doing a great job, you know what I mean? Like, motherfucker funny, you know what I mean? And he handcuffed himself, you know what I'm saying? And but Dan O'Brien, you know, he's talking up, going on about he never won a Royal Rumble. You know, he done it all. And you know, some real shit, like him saying this, like, you know what? You're right. You know, you deserve it. Because remember that year, that's everything. That year that he was supposed to win it, and Roman Reigns was the one that ended up winning. Remember that year?
Yeah, I don't think anyone could forget that year. They blew the shit out of him.
That was in Philly. Yeah, I don't know if there was a big snow storm the next day. Was that the one that they had like the episode kind of like, you know what I mean? They couldn't do it.
Yeah, I think that was it.
Yeah, but anyhow, so you got that storyline to connect, you know what I mean, for that match. But then in that, boom, Cesaro fucking song come out. That's another one, like, for me, you know what I mean, that I would love if he won the Rumble, you know what I mean? That's another one you can see, like once that they have, like, yo, we gotta start doing stuff with these people, you know what I mean? Cesaro came out, you know what I mean? He talking about, you know, everything that Brian was saying that he could have said it in 5 different languages. And then he trying to talk to, like, you know, something saying like he cares about him. Like, I ain't nobody want to talk to you. You know what I'm saying? And he just goes in there, you know. And, you know, he could cut a great promo. And then he opens his fucking, he has an open challenge. And lo and behold, Cleveland's own Dolph Ziggler, bebe, he came out of the scene. Bro, and that shit was awesome, you know what I'm saying? Because like, I knew, like, damn, Ziggler against Cesaro, you know you're going to get a banger. And that's what we got. You know, we got a fucking banger, but boom. Fucking Cesaro with the win, you know? And it's like, whoa, okay, I like this. But no Nakamura in sight, you know? And Nakamura was the one popping last week. See, so it's like the ones that should be getting, let's say, the cold push, you know, they being more promoted, you know what I'm saying? And I forget, you know, Ziggler, he's, I think, number 2 in the most appearances in the Rumble. You know what I mean? He got the most appearances. So for this, around this time, it's like, why not Ziggler? you know?
Yeah, it could be anybody, man. It could be anybody. But, you know, with that being said, you spoke about, of course, Sami Zayn doing this thing with the signs. Kind of reminds me of Sami Guevara with the signs. And then, you know, Sami Zayn sits down in the chair and hits the Bernie pose. Like, I fucking died laughing. And then you have Big E versus Apollo Crews ends in a disqualification because of Sami Zayn coming with that Huluva kick and what have you. But before that match, man, you had Sasha Banks. You had Bay out there going up against Reggie.
Yo,
that shit was entertaining.
It was entertaining, but that dude, it had no offense on Sasha.
I mean, Conor, what's your take, Prodigy, on that match?
I enjoyed it. I mean, for what it's doing, I feel like it's building up a good story. I just thought it was pretty good. Like, I didn't mind it by any means. It was just, could have been better, sure. But, I mean, for where it's going, I think it did its job. So, I mean, I have no complaints about it.
I mean, yeah, he had no offense, but, you know, is Vince really going to promote an intergender wrestling like that? A man, you know, being on a female? Like, nah, this is not like the Attitude Era. So it's like.
But like I said, man, they changing, you know what I mean? It seems like they're waking up, man. Like, maybe not, you know, maybe I guess giving them. But, like, all this shit, that you wouldn't see that. It was on Fox, you know what I mean? Like, when I saw that, I'm like, what the fuck? But then you got this motherfucker who looked like one of the dudes that carry the caskets and shit. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? Like, this dude doing flips. Like, dude is killing it. You know what I mean? I'm like, yo, this kid. You know what I mean? But he did not lay nothing. Nothing. He didn't give him nothing, but he, you know what I mean? You could see, like, he was a good base for Sasha. You know what I mean? And it was crazy. Like, where did this motherfucker come from? You know?
Catering. It got from anywhere. But, yo, the match itself, for what it was, it was okay. We know what it's going to lead to. Then we had Bianca Belair versus Bayley inside the obstacle course. Yo, at first, I was not a fan of it because I got instant flashbacks to Bobby Lashley's the obstacle course that he did, and then I got flashbacks to NXT, the original NXT. So at first, I wasn't for it before it was announced, but then, you know, they started to do it, and then, you know, Sasha Banks broke Bayley's ankles, dunked on her, you know. And then, you know, you had her deadlifting Otis, like...
Who you said? Who broke Bayley's ankles?
You know what I meant to say. Bianca Belair, but at the same time, you know what this is alluding to, right? WrestleMania.
Oh!
Right now. Bianca Belair versus Sasha Banks for the SmackDown Women's Championship.
She gonna win the Rumble, you're saying?
That's exactly what I'm saying.
I can get behind that. I think Bianca deserves it.
I second that.
Her ass off. Like, I think everything about it's a good idea. She's been looking great. As much as I love Bayley, everybody knows she's probably my favorite female performer right now. But Bianca's looking fantastic, and I personally cannot see anybody else winning that Rumble. It belongs to her.
It definitely belongs to Bianca. But yeah, I mean, it was a good obstacle course, seeing, you know, those two go. But, you know, at the end of the day, we know this is going to lead to, man. We know it's going to lead to. Then you had Big Head Corbin, not my words, Jey Uso's words, going up against Dominic Mysterio, who I forgot even worked there. Of course, Baron Corbin on the winning streak coming into the new year. That's nice. Then you had Paul Heyman versus Adam Pearce. Back to what you said. We back through it. Back to it, right? So, I didn't think this was going to be a real match at all. I ain't never seen Paul Heyman inside a wrestling match. And, turnabout's fair play, right? So, Paul Heyman faked their injury. Of course, we have Roman Reigns come in. Card is subject to change. Then you had Kevin Owens come through and
No, Jey Uso, man. Where was he?
Hey, you know, Jey Uso was probably preparing the table for his brother to return. Think about that. Because his timetable is right around this time to come back. Rumble season, like, February-ish. So, I don't know. Maybe we get both Usos returning at Royal Rumble. How about that? Bold prediction right here. We get Jimmy and we get Jey returning. So, but yeah. Kevin Owens puts the Tribal Chief through the announce table with ease, too. With ease. And Kevin Owens is the last man standing. So, my whole thing is, at the end of the day, yeah, this Wrestling Infinity War is definitely going on. But my whole thing is, you got AEW, you got MLW, you got Impact, you got WWE, NXT, Raw, SmackDown. Bro, and ROH is out there too. New Japan. Out of all of these shows, bro, throughout the week, SmackDown continues to be the best product on television. And it's funny that for years, SmackDown has been the best show on television. But now, finally, the ratings are showing it, number one. And number two, so is the quality in the product. And, you know, I'm just happy that SmackDown is doing the thing. But, I mean, overall, SmackDown definitely the show of the week, hands down. You all agree?
Yay, yay!
All right, we got agreement on that.
And he speaks for me as well.
So, I mean, basically, that's pretty much for the week in wrestling. Couple rumors and news out there. Really just news first and foremost, you know what I'm saying? WrestleMania is set to have 25,000 fans apiece at both nights.
That's dope. You know what I mean? I don't see myself pulling the trigger. You know what I mean? But then again, right now you got the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Tom Brady, 10 fucking Super Bowl, bro. Motherfucker. So, even though it's a pandemic, bro, Ybor City gonna be jumping. Nah, but it'll be dope, you know what I mean? Because you're going off that wave, you know what I mean? Super Bowl, most likely they're gonna win too. So, but nah, man. But yeah, they announced Tampa, Dallas, and Hollywood. That's big news.
Huge news, but 25,000 fans apiece, you know, it's manageable, it's doable. You know, and forever fans that they can't get in the stadium, just kind of put the screens in there like the Thunderdome, I guess. But, yeah, we got that going on. Then the next tidbit of rumor slash news out there, we kind of touched on it earlier. Taya Valkyrie, free agent. Dalton Castle, free agent. We touched on that last week. As well as another piece of rumor news. Just to go ahead and throw out there. Might as well put it out there. So, looks like we just may be getting another reunion coming up here soon. We may be getting a reunion in the form of a tag team, American Alpha. So, Jason Jordan is training for a comeback. What if we get this? What if we get American Alphabet? That's the big question. And last piece of news out there.
I know we can't go to this rabbit hole. This could be a big, like a show on itself. But we had The Undertaker on the Joe Rogan episode. Show, bro. On the podcast, bro. That shit rough a lot of feathers, bro. Dude was just don't give a fuck.
So if you're talking about the comment Undertaker made, he said that this generation is a little bit soft And real men don't play video games.
That's one of the things.
I mean, that's one of the things. I mean, there's a lot of things that he said in there, but at the same time, that man's retired. He's dedicated over 30 years.
He's on a legend contract.
Yeah, but at the same time, he could talk that shit.
But listen, I started watching it on YouTube. You know, it was on YouTube, and I watched most of it, but I didn't finish. When I went back, they had taken it down, and I'm like, oh. But then today, I was scrolling, and next thing you know, I see it. You know, because there was other people that probably recording. They had it in sections. You know, 8 minutes, 9 minutes, and then I see it from the Joe Rogan actual YouTube channel. They put it back, and talking to my dude earlier. They said they probably edited it. You know what I mean? I'm like, that probably was it. You know what I mean? So I might want to check it out again and see.
I mean, if they did edit it, they got every right to. I mean, but at the same time, Undertaker, whatever he says right now is gold, right? Man, the man has dedicated almost damn near 40 years of his life to this business.
My guy, and do you know one of the other things that he said? That he was on steroids. But, you know, and that was kind of like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Really? Like, what's going on?
I mean, you know, hey. If he did it, he did it. At the end of the day, I mean, it's over and done with now. Shit. It's like, I'm retired. If I took steroids 30 years ago, 40 years ago, what have you, it's over with. Like, it's cool. It's not the first time someone has said that they've taken steroids after the fact. You know what I mean? Hulk Hogan is one of them, you know? But other than that, man, that was one hell of a recap for last week. Make sure y'all do definitely, as we say every show, listen, too much negative energy can have you unbalanced mentally, emotionally, physically, and spiritually. Make sure y'all spread more positive vibes, all right? It takes very little to build someone up than it does to tear them down. Think about the logic. It could be backwards, but think about the message. And then, also, we got to slow down the spread of COVID, people. I know the vaccine is out there, whether you trust it or not. But we got to slow down the spread. It starts off with good hygiene. First thing we're going to need y'all to do is to wash your hands and wash your ass. Use soap. Tell them how to do it, Cheech.
From face to ass, not ass to face.
And on that note, we out. Connor, go ahead and hit them with it.
So long. Good night. Farewell. DJ
Khaled, I see. Bang!
Cool and Dre, I see you. All right. Pristine Jewelers in the building. El Boogie Lorena. Terrellis the Flies. Let's get it. That old thing back, pretty young thing with that OG crack. Straight savage when I got my Fenty on. Do the douce with a touch of deli on. She got a man and he's stuck in the feds. Said he gonna kill me cause she up in my bed. We wear chains that excite the knocks. Only G7s when the flights depart. Stash pesos and Turks and Caicos. Dapper dead on the first to break those. Not back to Caicos. Throw your rollies in the sky, my guys will take those. Lower east side, I'm up in NY. See me on the floor with Obi courtside. Baddies on deck, you know I'm loving them. Still in the meeting with Khaled. Another one.